What is a function? So we can say a function is a mathematical relationship which kind of has got an input and also gives us an output. So a very good example of a function is a linear function, which is in this form. Basically, we can talk about maybe 2x plus 1. So we are saying x is actually what? The input. So this is a function. It's an example of a function. So we're saying a function should have an input as well as what? The output. So the input in terms of the functions is what we call the domain. Then the output is what we get to call the range, the expected result of a function. Okay, so what type of functions do we have? As mentioned, we have got what we call linear functions. So linear functions, these are straight lines. Okay, so they are in the form y is equal to mx plus b. A very good example is what I'm just from talking about. So this is an example of a function, which is a linear function. So if you are to sketch it on a graph, say this is your x values and these are your y values. So you get to plug in the value of x at every point. So let's say you're at 1. You want to find the value of y, you plug in. So what you're going to have is 2, where there's x, we're going to put a 1 plus 1, which is going to give you a 3. Which I'm supposed to write there, so somewhere there. So it usually gets to come out like this. That's a linear function. So before we get to talk about the other different types of functions that we have, so apart from expressing it in this form, a function can also be expressed in this form. Okay. So some of the basic things that you have to know is how to determine the function of a given number. Let's say the function of 4, function of 1, let's say negative 1. How do you get to do that? So basically, when you're finding a function of a number, you just say function of that. So at every point where you have x in the equation on the right hand side, you plug in the given value. So in this case, 2 by 4 is 8 plus 1, you have a 9. You can try out function of negative 1. So function of negative 1 equal to where there is x, we are going to put negative 1 plus 1. So 2 times negative 1 is negative 2 plus 1, we have negative 1. Okay, the other type of functions that we have is we have quadratic functions. So these have got the x being squared part of the equation, maybe 2x squared plus 4x plus 1. So the form of such a function is ax squared plus bx plus c. So this is an example of the quadratic functions. Then generally going up, we can just say all these are what? So starting from the cubic function, we tend to call them polynomial functions, because we can classify them differently, but we can just say since the power is becoming bigger, we can say polynomial functions. So an example of a polynomial function is a cubic function. So as you might just look at the name, this one has got x at a certain point being cubed, the third power there, then bx squared. So this is the general form of such equations and a constant there. You may also have quadratic functions, the power 4, and so on and so forth. So we're going to talk about these functions in different videos, in two details, how to sketch them, how to determine their values at different points. So let's try to move on and talk about the forms of the equations that we should expect, or the types of functions, basically. So from by just looking at the relationship between the input and the output, we're able to classify functions. So let's say we have 1, 2, 3, and 4 as our inputs. Then this side, let's say we can just say maybe 10, 14, 9, 6. So let's try to come up with a relationship. So now let's say you have 1. So this type of a function, where all the members that are part of the input are related to one thing on the other side, this type of a function is said to be the function is said to be an onto function, meaning that every member of the input is mapped to something in the output. So it's called an onto function. Then on the other hand, you may have a case where the input and the output are just one to one, meaning that if you have A, B, C, if it's mapped to one, just one. So this is said to be a one-to-one function. Now, let's say, how about this function? If you look at this function, let's say our function is f of x is equal to x squared. So if you plug in the values there, what are you going to see? Let's try negative 3 first of all. So the function of negative, okay, then let's say negative 2 is going to be negative 2 squared, which is a 4. If you try in the positive value, f of 2 is going to be 2 squared and it will be 4 as well. So you are trying to see that the inputs, despite them being of opposite signs, they are giving us the same value, which is just what? 4. So this kind of a function where you are going to find that two or more inputs are matching up to one output, it is said to be many to one function. So it's many to one. Just from the context, just from what is happening there, we're able to see it's many to one. Well, somebody since we have many to one, somebody else may guess we also have one to many. So let's say this is your input and your output, your A, your B. Let's say A is producing one and also maybe four. So I'm afraid this is not a function. We don't have one too many functions, so it's just a relation between two sets. It's not a function. So you may be given a question to say an input is producing two, there's a relationship that is producing two outputs. So that's not a function. Okay. Let's move on. Let's try to talk about composite functions. So, what is a composite function? So, we can say a composite function is actually a function of another function. A composite function is a function of another function. Let's say we have f of x being equal to x squared minus 3x, and we also have another function, let's say g of x, which is equal to 2x plus 1. So of course we know this is the first function is a quadratic function and the other function is a linear function. So let's say they ask you to find f of g of x. That's the first question. Then the second question, they also ask you to find the function g of f of x. So how do you get to do that? So these are what we are calling composite functions, a function of another function. So remember we said that when you are taught to say function of maybe a number, maybe 2, you just have to plug in where there is x at every point where there is x, you plug in what you've been what you've been given. So it would be at every point where we have a 2 there, where we have x we'll put a 2, so it's going to be 2 squared minus. So we also have x here we'll put a 2, which is going to be 4 minus 6, giving us negative 2. So equally, when you are given a composite function, the same applies. So at every point, so it's very, very important to understand that what is going to be the function is what you started with. So for you to understand it better, we'll write it in this form. It's like you're trying to find a function of g of x. Okay. Meaning that you're working with a function that is, that you've been given initially, which is function f there. So at every point in that function where we have x, we are going to put what? We are going to put g of x. So I'll start. So initially we have x there, x squared. So it's going to be g of x. So it is substituting x squared minus 3. And where we have x again there, we are going to put the same. G of x. So that is what we call a function of a function. So let's try to simplify it. So you have g of x, which is 2x plus 1. So it's going to be 2x plus 1 squared minus 3, then 2x plus 1. So how do you expand that? So we know how to expand. It's just a matter of simplifying now. So 2x and 1. So that is going to be 4x squared plus 4x plus 1. Then this side, we are trying to open the brackets. You multiply by negative 3. So it's going to be minus 6x. Negative 3 by 1 is going to be minus 3. So at this point, we can simplify it. So let's have some space here. So we have 4x squared. So 4x minus 6x, those are like terms. It is going to give us negative 2x. Then 1 and negative 3 are also right terms. 1 minus 3 is minus 2. So that is your output. So that is a function of f of g of x. So you can pause the video and try out the other one before checking the solution. So what we have is g of f of x. Let me remove this. So g, we can write it in this form as well, f of x. So like I mentioned, you start with what is given first. That's the function that you're going to consider. So we've been given g. So we're going to write this in terms of, at every point we have x, we're going to plug in the function f. So it's going to be 2. So we have x, we'll put f of x, okay, plus 1. So what is the function of f of x? It's x squared minus 3x. So we plug in, plus 1. So this is going to be 2x squared minus 6x plus 1. And that is your function or function in such a case. So let's try to move on now and talk about an inverse of a function. So what is an inverse? So an inverse of a function, I would say, is kind of a function that reverses the output. So remember, when you have a function in this form, maybe let's say 2x plus 1. So what you're plugging in the input, let's say the function of maybe 2, it's going to be 2 multiplied by 2 plus 1, which is going to give us 5. So you're trying to come up with a function. If you plug in, if you get to plug in 5, it will give you your input. So that's what you call an inverse function. Now, let's say you've been given a function f of x mapped onto 3x plus 2. So this is your function. How do you get to find its inverse? So we can let this part be y. Okay. So we're going to have y is equal to 3x plus 2. We've written it in terms of an equation now. So we'd want to make x to be the subject. So we're going to have y minus 2 being equal to 3x. You divide by 3 both sides. So your x is actually going to be equivalent to y minus 2 over what? 3. So at this point, for you to find the function, the inverse, which we write in this form, you will need to take back the x where it was. So it's going to be x minus 2 over 3. So this is your inverse of that function. And we can try it out. So let's say we are dealing with the function of maybe the function of 2. Let's try the function of 2. So the function of 2 in such a case is going to be what? You're going to have 3 multiplied by 2 plus 2. 3 by 2 is 6 plus 2, that is 8. So you're trying to plug in 8 and see if you're going to find your input. We can try that out. So our inverse function is x minus 2 over what? 3. So we're trying to see if it's going to give us if it's going to reverse what we have. So let's try to plug in now 8. 8 minus 2 over 3. So 8 minus 2 is 6 over 3, which is what? A 2. So we're able to see that it has given us back the output. And that's what an inverse function does. Let's look at a second example under inverse functions. So feel free to pause the video and try it out. So we have function of x, 1 minus x over what? 1 plus x. You can pause the video and try it out. So all the same, we are going to let this be y. Y minus x over 1 plus x. So we have a y there. So we want to make x a subject. What can we do? We can cross and multiply. So when you cross and multiply, you have y multiplied by 1 plus x. Here you have a 1. So 1 by that is just going to be 1 minus x. So we want to make x a subject. We need to open the brackets there. So it's going to be y. Y times 1 is y. Y times x is xy equal to 1 minus x. So we need to take every part having x to one side. We need to take every part having x to one side. So what can we do from there? So this part is having x and that part is also having x. So we can let this one, we can take the one that is negative the other side. So we're going to have xy. This one goes the other side, it's going to become positive. On the other side, we're going to remain with 1. And the y is supposed to go the other side, so it's going to be minus y. So you're trying to make x a subject, so you can factorize it. So you have x, you remain with, at that point you remain with y, and 1 is equal to 1 minus y. So we just want x to be the subject. So x is equal to 1 minus y over y plus 1. So what we've done is just we've divided both sides, the left and the right, by y plus 1. So from there, we can now just take it back to the form that we're supposed to write it in. So the function, the inverse of that function is going to be, so at every point, remember, when you're presenting your solution, you need to take back the x variable. So it's going to be 1 minus x over x plus 1. And this is our inverse of that function. Yeah. So if you try to compare it, is it different or it's just the same? Because what I'm saying is on top we have 1 minus x Even here is 1 minus x. So down is x plus 1, which is the same as 1 plus x. So let's try it out if it's actually true. So now let's say we plug in maybe 2. So for a function, it's going to be 1 minus 2 over 1 plus 2. So what you have is negative 1 over 3. You can try it out on the other function. What are you going to have? So we're trying to plug in negative 1 over 3. Remember what we've plugged in there is 2. And it has given us negative 1 over 3. So we're trying to see if the inverse will give us the same. Of course, we've seen that the inverse is exactly the same function itself. So what happens when you plug in negative 1 over 3? So you are going to have 1 minus negative 1 over 3 divided by x minus... Okay, where is x? We put negative 1 over 3. So negative 1 over 3 plus 1. So what do we have? 1 plus 1 over 3 is going to be what? So that is going to be 4 over 3. So we have 4 over 3 divided by, then 1 minus 1 over 3 is what? It's 2 over 3. So 4 over 3 divided by 2 over 3 is the same as 3 by 2. So what are you going to have? So 2 there is 2. So 2 by 3 is 6. And what you're going to have is 2. So it has given us what we had inputted in the function. So when you've been given a function, then you find that the function is equivalent to an inverse. This is what you call a self-inverse what? A self-inverse function. So that's it for this video. Thank you very much for watching.